In our 2020 lead today, Democratic presidential candidates taking their shots at the frontrunner without even needing to mention his name. Joe Biden was the obvious target at the California Democratic Convention. Biden didn't make the trip, and as CNN's Leyla Santiago reports, based off the crowd's reactions to other more moderate Democrats, that might have been for the best.
A heated weekend for 2020 Democratic candidates, thanks to protesters.
Hey.
Progressive audiences, and each other.
You know, Vice President Biden can do what he wants to do. I'm going to work hard.
Presidential hopefuls campaigning in San Francisco took a more aggressive approach in some cases to distinguish themselves and their opponents, some taking aim at frontrunner Joe Biden.
We cannot go back to the old ways. We have got to go forward with a new and progressive agenda. We have got to make it clear that when the future of the planet is at stake, there is no middle ground.
Biden did not show up for the Democratic Party convention in California, the state with the largest number of delegates in an earlier than usual primary in 2020.
Our country is in a time of crisis. The time for small ideas is over.
The riskiest thing we could do is try too hard to play it safe.
My name is Joe Biden.
Instead, Biden kicked off Gay Pride Month at a human rights campaign gala in Ohio focused on President Trump and seemingly unfazed by any direct or indirect criticism made by fellow candidates. Criticism some of his fellow moderates who went to California heard from the crowd.
Socialism is not the answer.
Medicare for all may sound good, but it's actually not good policy, nor is it good politics.
Then there was this.
Hello, okay.
A protester rushing the stage towards Senator Kamala Harris, forcing her to walk off and her husband, Doug Emhoff, to step in and pull the microphone away from the protester, later tweeting, "I love Kamala Harris and would do anything for her."
And Biden's campaign declined to comment about the criticism. But, you know, as we talk about the criticism and kind of see it ramp up on the campaign trail, important to note, there's this thing called We Are Indivisible Pledge, in which 17 candidates have signed on pledging to make the primary constructive. One of those who has not signed on, Joe Biden. Jake.
Leyla Santiago, thanks so much. Let's bring the experts back. Take a listen to some of the other veiled jabs that 2020 Democrats took at Joe Biden over the weekend.
Some say if we all just calm down, the Republicans will come to their senses. But our country is in a time of crisis. The time for small ideas is over.
We don't need a crime bill. We need a hope bill.
Nia, we seem to be in a new phase of the 2020 campaign. Candidates are going to step up their attacks on Joe Biden, even if they don't mention his name. It's clear who they're talking about.
That's right. I mean, these aren't veiled references at all to Joe Biden. It'll be interesting to see if they sort of take their gloves off even more and start to name him. The next big date on the calendar is the debates coming up. So we'll see if they want to spend their time on the debate stage there going after Joe Biden, or if they want to use their time, is going to be, you know, not so much time because so many people are going to be on stage. Do they want to spend their time introducing their own ideas? But it's clear Biden is a frontrunner. The question is he a strong front runner or is he a weak front runner? They think he's a bit of a weak front runner. You know, the argument is that he's not out meeting voters in the way that some of these other candidates are as often as they are. But listen, he is still in an enviable position of being as far ahead as he is in such a crowded field.
And Kristen, Biden was not at the convention in California. And as you heard, Biden's team declined to comment on any of this. But instead, this weekend, he was going after President Trump and the Trump administration. He's running as a front runner. Do you think it's smart for his team to ignore the Democratic field, essentially, and focus only on President Trump?
At the moment, 100%. I mean, of course, as the debates unfold, he'll be on a stage with other contenders. He'll have to defend his ideas from whatever those criticisms or attacks look like from the rest of the field. But I think he's being smart. Look, going on stage somewhere where people are getting booed for saying we shouldn't become a socialist country is probably not going to be the kind of audience that's going to praise someone who might be a little more moderate or try to be a more, let's bring everybody together kind of figure. So I think he made the smart play in choosing to sit that one out.
And Richard, take a listen to Democratic Congressman Seth Moulton. He was my guest on State of the Union. I asked him about Biden's vote in favor of the war in Iraq, which Moulton fought in as a Marine. Take a listen.
It was a mistake because we should have been a lot more careful about going into Iraq. We should have questioned the intelligence. We should have made sure that we exhausted every opportunity before we put young American lives in danger.
Four tours in Iraq, he has a right to make that argument. What do you make of it?
Yes, he does, and it's a replay of 2007-8, right? You know, when you have a front runner who's running a strong campaign, a strong candidate, making the electability argument, but you have a core question that the Democrats really aren't with you on, then your long record, the very thing that gives you that strong platform and electability, starts to look like a very weak thing. And Hillary Clinton suffered from having that voting record. Remember that President Clinton said that Barack Obama, well, he didn't have to vote on this, he just gave a speech. But, you know, being in that position, standing for more change, not less change, that's really where the heart of this Democratic Party is right now. And that's where it was in 2007.
Caitlin?
Yeah, you can see that. And that's going to be what the president and his campaign, his reelect effort, are trying to frame this in questions of that as they are going forward into 2020 and what they're going to be saying about this. They're going to be hoping to use their past decisions against them. It's going to be interesting to see if that works. We've seen the president try to do it while he was overseas in Tokyo. We can expect him to continue to do it while he's overseas this week. And the question is, how is it going to affect and shape the Democratic primary?